We all have 23 pairs of chromosomes, but what is actually on each one of those chromosomes? Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write your ancestors' story along the way. One of the questions that I've actually had several people ask in comments has to do with what is on these 23 chromosomes. What do each one of them mean? And the simple answer to that is each one of them don't mean something. They're actually made up of lots of genes, hundreds, in some cases thousands of genes on a single chromosome, that then is what makes up ourself. So today, what I wanted to do is I wanted to go through and I wanted to highlight each pair of chromosomes and something that is on that chromosome that affects us. This could be a physical trait. It could be a disease that you might have heard of. But I want to emphasize, this is not the only thing that is on each one of these chromosomes. This is actually just a little tiny snippet of that chromosome. And you can go and do some research if you're interested more in each one of these traits. So let's go through and let's talk about all of these different traits. Starting with chromosome number one. There is actually a gene on there for brain development. And one of the really great things about this gene is that it is a gene that is unique to humans. And when you think about humans and some of the different things that we do compared to other animals, namely speech and the ability to plan out complex things, we have this capacity that really is related to just a few genes on our genome, and one of them is on chromosome number one. So thank chromosome number one for not only your brain development, but everybody else's brain development as well. On to chromosome number two. Well, I'm gonna call this the Shiver gene, and somebody actually did call it that, although that's not the official name. But there is a gene that regulates how we sense temperature, cold, and you know, getting the shivers from that. And so this is really interesting because, hey, we think about, you know, this is cold, we're shivering, or we're trying to warm up, we're getting goosebumps in that, and some of that reaction can be traced back to this gene on chromosome number two. Now I want to reiterate again that something as like shivering is not just a single gene. There's actually several things that are all working together, but this is one that has to do with how we sense hot and cold that is regulated by that gene. Now, number three, well, there's a gene on there for night vision. In other words, if you can see well at night, then you have a particular version of that gene, or if you don't see well at night, you probably have a defective copy of that gene. Now humans, we don't have great night vision, but we have adequate night vision. And that's what's interesting about this gene is we can see it in lots of other animals, and particularly in animals that see well at night, they have a certain copy of this gene, which with other genes as well, not just on chromosome number three, but on other chromosomes, those genes all work together to give really good night vision or not so good night vision. But night vision starts out on our chromosome number three. On to number four, fingerprints. Huh, when you think about that, fingerprints actually start with a gene on number four. And there's a defect where if you have a defective set of genes for fingerprints on number four, then you actually don't develop fingerprints. You have smooth skin on your fingers, and it's really rare, but it does happen. Now this gene is just for the development of fingerprints. The actual pattern of your fingerprints, it is influenced by other things as far as how you developed in the womb and what you were touching in the womb at the time. But the ability really to develop those fingerprints starts with this gene on chromosome number four. Now, chromosome number five has a gene for our white blood cells. It's used in the creation of our white blood cells. There's specific proteins that our white blood cells have that our red blood cells don't have. And it is genes that make these proteins, and particularly on chromosome number 5, there is a gene that makes the proteins, the protein that is used specifically for white blood cells. Now, there's lots of proteins in a single blood cell, and so this isn't the only one. And I keep on wanting to say that because this list has only one thing for each chromosome, but there's really lots, dozens, hundreds of things on each chromosome that it does for you. Well, number 6, on chromosome number 6, there's actually a gene that determines your resistance to chemotherapy. Some cancer patients don't respond to chemotherapy as well as others, and that can be traced back to some genes, one of which is on chromosome number 6. So some of these things are, you know, bad for us because we may have diseases or cancers that we need chemotherapy for, but if we have this gene that resists it, then that chemotherapy, that treatment is not going to be as effective. So genes can help us, genes can hurt us sometimes. On to chromosome number 7, where we have a gene that tells us whether we are full or hungry. It's basically a protein that lets our system know, oh yeah, you're full or you're hungry. So it helps regulate our appetite. So if you want to blame chromosome number 7 for that delicious ice cream that you just can't get enough of, which is me, then blame chromosome number 7, because that's the one that has that gene which helps tell you whether you're full or hungry. Now, chromosome number 8 has a gene that is involved in bone development, and in particular, those who have osteoporosis, they found that there is a specific version of that gene that they had. It's almost like it is the genetic component of this osteoporosis. So this brings up something that is always good to understand, is that with a lot of diseases and conditions in life, there is a genetic component, but it's not always just a genetic component. There may be some environmental factors as well. Osteoporosis is one of those. You may have, we'll say, the bad gene for osteoporosis, but if some of the environmental factors aren't present, you may never actually get osteoporosis. Likewise, you may be doing a lot of the things that you should to prevent osteoporosis, but if you have the bad genes, you might get it anyway. And you might have good genes and still get osteoporosis. So it's a little bit confusing sometimes. And that's why I'm leery about telling people, well, this always does this. Except when we go to chromosome number 9, there is a gene, a single gene, and I've talked about this before on the channel, that determines whether your blood group is A, B, or O. This is one of the few traits that can be nailed down to just one gene. There's not an environmental factor involved, it's just genetics. So whether you are blood group A, whether you're B, or whether you're O, you can look at this specific gene on chromosome number 9. Now, chromosome number 10, let me explain this, because I say biological clock, and many people think of women having babies in their 30s when they hear biological clock. But this is actually everybody's biological clock. When you think about it, we all like to be awake during the day, and we all like to sleep at night. That is our biological clock. It helps to regulate what our body's doing during the day and what our body's doing during the nighttime. And why this is important is because there's been a lot of research around this, particularly with people who work odd shifts, and they find, you know, you're basically messing with this genetics and this biological function of our body whenever you're staying up all night and trying to sleep during the day. I actually worked a rotating shift for about 2 years, and during that time, I would no more than about 5 hours a night, which was really during the day. When I was on the overnight shift, I couldn't sleep more than 5 hours a night. It didn't matter. I'd be on it, you know, after one day, after 10 days, I still couldn't sleep more than 5 hours a night. So that I can blame on chromosome number 10. It's trying to keep me awake during the day, and it's trying to help me go to sleep at night. Well, chromosome number 11 is for, there's a gene, it's not all of chromosome 11, it's just a gene on it for sickle cell anemia. And this is another fascinating thing I find with genetics and with DNA, is one of the things that we can see is we can trace where peoples have all migrated over thousands and thousands of years. And it all traces back to Eastern Africa. And there's some of the earliest groups that broke off that went to Western Africa. And this gene for sickle cell anemia is much more prevalent in Africans and those of African descent than it is in any other group around the world. And that's because it probably developed there. Now, in looking at this, it sounds like it actually developed as a defense against malaria or one of the other diseases that you find in the tropics of Africa. And so that development has now been passed down through hundreds and thousands of generations. And so people who are of African descent are much more susceptible to this because the gene pool of Africans has more of these sickle cell anemia genes in it than do those groups of people that migrated down to Southern Africa and those that migrated out of Africa. So number 11 is sickle cell anemia. Now number 12, I say sweat. Chromosome number 12 doesn't make you sweat, but what chromosome number 12 has on it, it has a gene that creates a protein which is secreted in your sweat, which helps to kill or clean your skin from harmful bacteria. Pretty cool, I think. If we look at chromosome number 12 and we narrow it down just a little bit, it is you know, putting out stuff that is killing that bacteria on your body to help keep you healthy. So chromosome number 12, whenever you sweat, be thinking about chromosome number 12. You are sweating out stuff that chromosome number 12 is telling you to make. Now, chromosome number 13 is one that many people are aware of. The BRCA, for breast cancer. It is the gene, or really a series of genes that all affect people who get breast cancer. Now, again, this is one that has a genetic component as well as other components, but there's more of a genetic component to breast cancer than some of the other diseases and symptoms that I've talked about. So this is one, whenever you hear about that BRCA2, I think it's BRCA2, then think about chromosome number 13. That is where that gene is on. With that, we've gone through just over half of all of the chromosomes and identifying a trait or a condition that is associated with each one. If you have any questions about what is on any of the chromosomes, put it in the comments below and I'll try to answer it. And stay tuned for next week when we will do part 2 and finish up the 23 chromosomes.